Okay, so to start second day, let's start with some question. Question. Okay, so let's recap. So before reaching to the slide, I think we started with the plain definition of project, a temporary endeavor for achieving a specific objective, a unique outcome, maybe a result, maybe a deliverable, right? And then we talk about project management. And we discussed that there are two types of thing, one is technical and the other is management. There are two types of activities in a project, and these activities can be categorized in technical and management. We also saw that most of the work is technical in the project, and the management work is normally not more than 20%, it's somewhat 10-20%, and in some cases it could be 25%. Or it is more depending upon the situation. But normally we can broadly say it is the 80-20%. 80% is technical and 20% is management. And we also talk about that management is the place where most of the problem occurs. And in fact, our 80% of the problems is in the management area. So if we focus on this management area, that is only 20%, we can get rid of most of the problems in the project. We face problems because we do not have capability to handle this 20%, or we do not have focus on that, or we do not have enough resources to do that, or we do not have intention to do that. Because of that, it is done half-hearted, or it is done like not with the focus. If some problems are left in management area, because the other portion is 80%, it amplifies in that proportion. So a small problem in management area actually amplifies and give a greater impact on the technical side. And if you see most of the technical problems you face in your project, if you look at the root cause of these, most of the root cause you will find in the management decisions. And management is basically a decisions making. Okay, so we discuss about project management, and then we discuss about what are the portfolio, program. So I think we discussed a lot about program and portfolio. So if anyone can like to describe what was the difference between portfolio and program. Anyone? Correct explanation is not mandatory. Okay, so whatever your understanding is, you can speak out, and we can definitely like fix if it is not correct. And that's what the reason we are here. What I just saying, portfolio is a holistic picture while program is a subroutine. Yeah, but there is a basic reason. See, portfolio and program both are group of projects. And we discussed about that, why we are grouping them. The intention of grouping is creating a difference between portfolio and program, right? Okay. Yeah, I was just thinking that if you can more talk about that, but think anyway, see, there are two things, this portfolio and program. The basic reason behind that is the purpose of grouping the projects. The purpose of grouping the project. So when we group the projects, because there is something common among them, then we call it a program. This group is called program. Like client is common, like technology is common, right? And when we group the projects together to achieve a specific objective of the organization, then we call it a portfolio. Therefore, business verticals become portfolio. So business verticals are normally portfolio, that is true, but a process, it is a process approach. I'm not sure, because a process approach is project also. What happens when we bring them together, these projects which have something in common, their collective management become more efficient and effective than managing them separately, right? And why it is business portfolio? Because business portfolio is normally having object organize, carrying organization objectives, and they are put, these verticals are made to keep this, keep the that objective in the mind and bringing all the projects together. It could be, this business objectives could be like financials, penetrating into a specific market, demonstrating technology, better governance is normally program. The better governance objective is basically for the program. The portfolio, the basic, the reason for portfolio is achieving its objective of the organization. Governance, better governance is actually giving it that together these projects are become more effective. It is easy to manage them. Quality as a program, right? Absolutely. Yeah, better delivery, better customer satisfaction, better technology buildup, like that. Service support, right? So besides when portfolio, we talk also talk about project management office. Okay, no problem. Paro, you have the working office today? You are working today? Okay, so we talk about project management office. And project management office, we said that this is a support function which help project manager in planning, in monitoring, in facilitating, doing some office work, reporting the project progress, escalating the matter to the management. But in many organizations, PMO has been implemented in a very different manner. So do not go with this standard definition, because PMO is loosely defined in many places. Some places it's only doing this shared resources, managing shared resources. Some places is only giving templates and procedures but not interfering into the project. Some places it will doing only office work, supporting from the papers and to generating reports, kind of collecting data, generating reports only. And very some of only some organizations who have implemented with the complete ownership that this group is responsible to provide all the support to the project, whatever it is required. Okay. We talk about operations and basic difference between the operations and project. We saw that project is a temporary and operation is ongoing. Project delivers something unique. Operations deliver repetitive deliverables. We also talk about business value, and we say that every project creates some kind of business value, and project success largely depend upon the business value. We also talk about role of the project manager, and we say that the project management capability is defined in three terms: the knowledge, performance, and the personal. And these three way we assess the knowledge, and we understand that how capable the project manager is. The organization culture make a lot of difference, and the, how the organization performs, what are the policies, what are the objectives, what are the values they really value, how, what kind of management the organization has, what kind of, in which country it works. Compact. Lalit, you joined as compact. Hi, Lalit. Hello. Yeah, good evening. You are Lalit, right? Your name is appearing as Compaq. We'll change, right? In the file, in the menu, in the file, I think there is an option called edit your name and email. Please do that. Because our timekeeping is done by the software, and software doesn't understand that Lalit is Compaq. And that's why we especially wrote in the email that please log in with the same name and same email ID, so that it becomes easier for us to keep a log. And because your certificate depends upon, we don't have any time like attendance sheet or so. This actually, it records your in and out, give us the time you are there in the workshop, and that actually the basis of issuing you the certificate of 35 hours. In the top menu file, in this GoTo meeting menu at the top, okay, yes. Great. So we all have to learn also through this. Okay, so I said this organization structure, the way of working, the environment, political scenario, commitment, the management, internal policies, the risk tolerance level, authority given, everything actually ultimately impact the way project get executed. And therefore, if you see at this chart, you see it's a matrix and it's showing a different type of organization and what exactly happened or what is the nature or how the project management or project manager's role actually come into picture and how the projects are executed. I would leave this slide for you to understand and guess what exactly it is showing, what message it is giving. It's not exact, but what message is trying to give. Can you give me an idea that what message the slide want to give? No, it's not a basic chart. It is, you see the title, it is saying organization structure influence. So how the structure of the organization influence the project and the role of the project management.
I think basically we do have two types of project management. One is a functional manager and another is a project manager. So basically where we fit exactly in the organization. So if it is a functional organization, then probably the project manager role is very less. Whereas a projectized organization, the project manager role is very, very much, and the functional manager role is not very limited or not at all in the project size.
Okay. I think largely you have told the crux of this story. Let me little bit put here and there in that. It definitely shows that there are three types of organization. The organization could be functional, could be projectized, or could be a hybrid mix of project functional and projectized. So that will be divided into three portions, that is the weak matrix, balance matrix, or strong matrix. The balance matrix also called matrix. So when somebody asks you matrix, means it's a balance matrix. The influence of the functional and projectized both. So what is a functional organization? The functional organization is an organization is similar to pharmaceutical, where technology make all the difference, where individual functions work independently and they are responsible for doing their own stuff. So there is a in any organization, if I say there is a there are suppose five technologies. So you talk about that, okay, in a simple I say if you take a software company, you say there is a technology called open source, there is a mainframe technology, there is a Microsoft technology. So there are three different functions. There will be another function who will be looking into the user interface. So there is a user interface function. And these people work in their own area and do not have much interaction with other functions. But unfortunately, there is no client who only comes to the organization for only user interface work or only for the Microsoft technology or only for mainframe technology or something like that. Or normally the clients which are coming to the IT companies, they are more or they need a small bits of 2-3 functions. And therefore most of the IT companies actually get into a projectized mode. While on the functional side, if you look at pharmaceutical company, there are various functions. Basically they are divided into the area of research. In which area the company want to get into and want new products to launch. So every function, people are known in a in a pharmaceutical company, the people are known for their patents. Means they have taken a line and they continuously do some research in that, and one after another they produce new product in the same line. They often change their line. They change line. If they change line, they move from one line to another line. There are few things in a pharmaceutical company which requires input from multiple functions. There will be possibility, but there are few in that case. So therefore, pharmaceutical companies are mainly organized as functional organization, while the IT companies, especially small IT companies, are mainly function as a projectized, because projectized means only project. Means the team come together to execute a project, and once the project is closed or project is over, this team get dispersed. Where they will go? They might go to a free pool, where they need not to do anything but to wait for the next project. This situation never arises in a functional organization. In a functional organization, people are always busy with their work, and their line is already decided. Once they join the company, like in a manufacturing, in an auto manufacturing, you say if you have joined a designs function, then you continue in the design function a long time. And when the car is assembled, design does its work, and the assembly is doing its own work, and so on. So most of the small IT companies are projectized, pharmaceutical companies are functional, many auto companies or manufacturing companies are also function. But the new companies, if you look at manufacturing, they are kind of matrix. In fact, if you look at the big IT companies, they are also matrix. If I take an example of Infosys, it is something like they have verticals which are focused on projects, and they have horizontals which are focusing on technology. So one function is for specific one mainframe technology, one function is a Java technology, one function is .NET technology, one function is on the user interface technology. And when the projects come, when the projects come, the people from these functions are allocated to the project. But once they allocate it, they become part of the project, and now they need to follow the project manager. And that's why we say the project manager authority is very high in the projectized organization. Project manager's role is full-time and the authority is high. Whatever project manager says, it happens there. Very high, almost total. On the other side, if a project come in a pharmaceutical company or something like that, a functional organization, what happens? There will be 3-4 functions involved in it. There will be a major role by the one function, and some other function will also play in the role. So what will happen? The functional manager of that function which is playing major role will take up as a project manager's role, which will not be a project manager but become a project coordinator, kind of project facilitator or project coordinator. So the people of the other function will also work on the project, but they will not come to the project. They will remain in their functional unit, but they will also contribute into the projects. The whole scenario appears like this, that if functional or the project priorities come here, or there is a contest between functional and project priorities, in this the resource is more inclined to do his functional work over the project work, while here the resource is more inclined to do project work over the functional work. Therefore, because the projects are not formally bound, it is basically a kind of a structure where the people remain with their units but they contribute, therefore resource availability remain low, while it is here I, because the resources get allocated to the project and they remain with the project. Who controls the budget? Definitely here the one of the functional manager. Here is one is the project manager. The project manager's role is part-time. Basically, some of the functional manager will also be playing as a part of, as a project manager, or maybe a project coordinator, I will say. And because part-time, it will say project coordinator. Administrative staff will also be will be shared and part-time, where it will be specifically made for project. Now, because things are quite streamlined in functional, everybody knows that what are happening in between, and only functional normally working in a horizontal manner. So the communication is streamlined. Here also it is streamlined. But what happens in the matrix organization, you have two managers. One is project manager, another is functional manager. Both have to contribute in the same project. Functional manager providing his resources to the project get allocated, but he also has to do his functional work from the same resources. While the project manager get resources from function, but has to get the job done from the of the project only. So when there is a competing requirement from the functional and from the function and the from the project, the resources are normally confused, because one person, the project manager, has the authority on them to get the things done, while their appraisals may be written by functional manager, because the functional manager owns the resources, because ultimately the project will finish, the resources will go back to their functional unit. And that's create the challenge, and that's make the communication in the matrix organization quite complex. And because there is a flavor of both the organization, therefore it is complex, and it is in the balance matrix, or say matrix organization, it is basically highly complex. Does that make sense? Yeah, it is fully technical type actually. The functional organizations are fully technical type. Totally technology makes sense there. Okay, two things will reappear all the time in all the knowledge areas, we will go ahead with all the chapters. One is called Organization Process Asset, and other is called Environmental Enterprise Environmental Factor. I will explain you here what these things mean, and then we will not discuss them again and again when they will come reappear in all the chapters and all the processes as such. So organization process assets are nothing but your guidelines, your templates provided by your quality department or by PMO or by any identified department, procedures, your knowledge base, internal wikis, any issue database, defect database, or any kind of database within that, configuration database. Basically, knowledge, all the kind of documents and the knowledge which is available in the organization in a tangible form. Like knowledge is also available in the case of like as a database, as a knowledge database, you can search it. All these things are organization process assets. So your policies, guidelines, templates, procedures, standards, benchmarking data, baseline data, all this is SOPs, right? SOPs, they are organization process assets. While enterprise environmental factors are something like political scenario, organizational culture, the style of governance, something non-tangible. It creates an environment, but it's not a document. It's impacting your project, but it is not something which is a document. It's a non-document item. Infrastructure available. How much space is provided to work? What kind of socio-political scenario is there in the organization? In which country you work? What are the policies and procedures and the type of environment there in that country? The law, project management information system, the system which help you to manage your projects. Those things which are not most of them are non documentary. There is no documentation of that. Those things are environmental factors. Something which is getting created by behavior of the people, behavior of the organization, geographical reasons, some database which is taken from outside of the organization, not within the organization. The way management behave, management tolerance, all these things are basically environmental factors. The artifacts in different process will appear differently under these environments, but this is the largely what is the meaning of it. Absolutely. The type of hierarchy the organization has, that is also part of the environmental factor. The reporting relationship, which we normally say. All your documents which help you to do projects or which will become constraint for you. So look at this. Organization process assets. They are the documents which help you to do the project. But look at the other side. They will also become constraint for you. Because if the organization has set a procedure to do, they will expect you do only that way. And if you have to do a different way, you have to take a permission, approval, and prove that doing different way will be beneficial. On the other side, environmental factors are normally put you through a constraint. They are normally constraint, but they are also facilitator because they will help you to do the project. अब मैं इसको ऐसा कह सकता हूं कि ये गंगा की धारा है, आप उस साइड में जाओगे तो आसानी से काम हो जाएगा आपका, आप इसके अपोजिट चलने की कोशिश करोगे तो बहुत मुश्किल हो जाएगा। तो नदी है, नदी की धारा है, दिस इज द एनवायरमेंटल फैक्टर। यू यू अंडरस्टैंड कि द करंट इज विच साइड एंड ट्राई टू मूव विद द करंट, धारा के साथ बहेंगे तो आसानी होगी, उसको हम समझ लेंगे, तो अदरवाइज इट विल बी ए प्रॉब्लम ऑल ओवर। मैनी पीपल डू नॉट अंडरस्टैंड दिस एंड दे आर रेसिस्टेंट एक्चुअली। वन नीड टू अडॉप्ट द ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल स्ट्रक्चर कल्चर एक्चुअली, वन अंडरस्टैंड एंड बिकम दैट वे, एंड इफ यू कैन नॉट बिकम दैट वे आई विल से लुक आउट फॉर अदर ऑप्शंस। इफ यू देर आर सम स्टैंड, सम कुछ प्रैक्टिसेस हो सकती हैं किसी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन में जो आप कहो कि यार दिस आई कैन नॉट डू, देन यू हैव टू मूव ऑन, और यू वर्क टू चेंज दोस थिंग्स। नीदर यू आर वर्किंग टू चेंज देम नॉर यू आर लुकिंग फॉर अदर ऑप्शंस एंड ट्राइंग टू स्ट्रगल विद दोस थिंग्स, आई थिंक योर लाइफ विल बिकम स्ट्रगल ओनली। Don't expect any success in such scenario. But if you make them change, you can become a hero also. But it is not very difficult. आप नदी की जो फ्लो है उसको चेंज करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं, ऐसा हो सकता है, बट बहुत उसके लिए काफी मेहनत और काफी परेशानी उठानी पड़ सकती है, बट अगर मैं कर दिया तो फिर आप हीरो भी हो जाओगे। Okay, tell me, look at this, and can you tell me what is the definition of a stakeholder? Ajay, the adaptability is the factor, but let me tell you also, adaptability, there is a limit to adaptability actually. We should not be extremely adaptable. In fact, excess of everything is wrong. Yes, I think somebody wants to speak.
I think this is Bhavra. I think stakeholder means a person who is interested on the project. Anybody, so it could be a project member, or it could be a sponsor, or a project manager, or a PMO, or anybody
who is interested or in the project.
Could be a public also. Right.
Okay. That is right, but it is more than that. Can somebody add into this? Whatever Bhavra said is right. It is more than that. Accountable for each function and result of the project means the consent function you're talking about. They are a stakeholder, but like I think Bhavra has said that anybody interested in the project is a stakeholder. What's more? Put values to the organization in terms of project profit. Okay. What exactly you want to say? A group of people who invest in the organization. You are right with respect to organization. When we talk about invest the stakeholder with respect to organization, they are right. But here our context is project. Yeah, bring time, money, right?
To add more, I think stakeholders might be a positive stakeholder or negative stakeholder. So people who are negative, those are also considered as a stakeholder.
Means who can impact negatively the outcome of the project.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. They are stakeholders. You see, in fact, the project manager had to identify such people first.
Yeah. That you have to do first only, so otherwise it would be difficult to manage the project.
Yeah, you will be struggling all the time along with these people. Alliances, yeah, alliances could be. See, the thing is that any person who has to contribute or take away or can impact the outcome of the project, who has a takeaway, who can contribute to the project, or who can impact the outcome of the project, is a stakeholder. So people who are interested in the project, they are looking for outcome. They have some takeaway from the project, so they become. But many times the people are required for doing the project work. They may not be interested, but they are required because they have to contribute in the project. We need to identify and pull them into the project. Suppose you need to collect requirements. Now many departments may not be, they maybe have to contribute, they have to provide some inputs to the project, but they may not be concerned about it. But we need to bring them up because their contribution is important. Now, some people who can impact the outcome of the project, they are normally powerful people, either positively or negatively. Some politics is going on. Your group has some tussle with another group head, another group head try to do something negative. You have to identify him also and see that how you can keep him away from the projects and how you can save the projects from any kind of outcome. But on the other side, you also have to identify many times on the client side, the some senior person, the client side, okay, very senior person, he's like, several such projects are going on in his project. He may not be too much interested or too much or little interested in your project, but sometimes he could be very important. Suppose this project is falling into his portfolio. Suppose he is managing about 15 projects. Now he has a crunch of money. Now he is looking for which project to get rid of. So if you have not identified him as a one of the important stakeholders, and this person all of a sudden find that because he's crunch of money, he's looking that which project to shred, he find that okay, this project is not important for him, and he will say let's get away. So for him it is just one project closed and his object will be done because he has little takeaway from this project, but it will greatly impact for all the project concerned, all the people concerned with this project. So the project manager of this project must identify such kind of stakeholder, keep them aware and keep them stay informed about the outcome of the project, and must relate the outcome of this project and their takeaways of those people. I have seen many projects which have been like all of a sudden get closed, and somebody, a senior on the client side, come into picture and say, okay, this outcome is not so important, please close this project because we don't have money. And all of a sudden the project got like abandoned or closed. Sometimes they will decently tell you that, okay, we want to hold this project. They will tell you when we have to restart or resume it. That's a decent way of abandoning the project. You might also have seen some of the project like that. Sometimes they all of a sudden get closed. And the reason is that we couldn't identify those people as stakeholders and couldn't keep them satisfied. So project governance is a kind of an oversight function, and which give guidance, help project management team to troubleshoot some in case of some problems. Otherwise, it is merely giving directions and the oversight to the project, so that in anything goes wrong, the actions can be taken. The project team includes the project manager and project management staff. Some other people may not be directly called project team, but they may provide their contribution in the case of any expert, customer, user, seller, any partner. The project life cycle looks like this. The project starts with the initiation, when we conceptualize what need to be delivered as part of this project, and we come out with a charter. A charter tells what are the objectives, what are the milestones, actually the guide for the project. This taking the chart, the project manager prepare a plan. The staff also increases, and they start doing some planning plus some delivery part as such. And once the planning is completed, the project plan is the outcome of that. Most of the efforts get executed during execution, as we are discussing yesterday also, that you have one project manager and 9 people who are actually doing technical work. So this is where the deliverables are produced, and most of the efforts of the projects get spent during execution. This is where we implement our project plan and people produce deliverables. So this chart actually shows us that most of the efforts of the project which are estimated are spent or are executed during execution. And once the deliverables are ready, we soon wrap up everything and close the projects with lesson learned and transition the outcome of the project to the operations. In the beginning, stakeholder influence is high. As I was discussing yesterday, that uncertainty is also high in the beginning. Project managers, mainly the primary job is to bring down, it looks like product life cycle. Yeah, product life cycle is little bigger than project life cycle, because product life cycle keep going on after project is over, because the product has a long life than project. So project life cycle is part of the overall product life cycle. Okay, so similarly, as we start, because very few deliverables are started in the beginning, and we move ahead, more and more deliverables will be produced. Therefore, the cost of change increases. Right? The cost of change increases. Okay. Hello, getting now? Yes, okay. So the cost of change is actually, if you suppose you have decided something about the project. So you have decided that this is to be done. Now some changes come up. You know, we do not want product like that. Can you increase the size of the project, the product? Now initially, because product is not being produced, or the items which are actually preparing the which are actually construct of the product are not being produced, the cost of change is very less. You just change the design. Now if the some part of the products are, some construct of the products are produced, then it is not just changing design here, but changing the product, the construct of the product as well. Therefore, the cost of change increases. And this is one of the reason that stakeholders' influence come down, because the cost of change is increasing. Right? So cost of changing the scope of the project is actually increases as you produce a product of the, or the produced deliverables in the project. Increase in the budget during the implementation of the project. Reason may be change in design of project. Quite possible, it happens. So budget, if the change, if design is changed, if the product, if some requirements are changing, then definitely the budget may increase, and it happens so. In most of the project, if you have even a 6-month project, there is a very likely that you will see some kind of changes. So we should be ready for that, and that's what planning is all about. We should expect that some kind of changes can happen, and therefore we should be ready to see that if the changes can be implemented. But we also have to be ready that unnecessary changes should not come into picture, into project. Otherwise, it will escalate the budget unnecessarily. Right, just give me a moment. Yeah, the Bandra Worli Sea Link is a story in itself, actually. That was a problem in itself. So it was a long story, is it? Because of the, there are a lot of political interference and a lot of changes it is seeing, a lot of environmental issues. If you do not take care of all those things, your things will definitely will like be going to hit the project. Uncertain, will it be better job if project manager defines uncertainty of the project for cost resources? That is what called risk is. That is what we call risk is. Risk is nothing but risk is something which is budgeted. Otherwise, we do not call that as a risk. We say it's a known thing. If you have identified a risk, you must budget for it. So risks are normally budgeted. Yeah, there are many things actually in the government sector. Nowadays, there are more things than actually you expect. Okay, now in a project from initiation to like closure, it is the whole thing is divided into five process group or project five process groups, and one is called initiating process group, where the processes are actually for conceptualizing a project. The planning processes help us whatever is conceptualized in the initiation to prepare a good plan for it. The execution processes are to ensure that the whatever the planning processes are, like you have put up a plan, that get executed properly. And monitoring and controlling processes are mainly to understand deviation of execution from the plan and then taking the corrective measures. And the closing process ensures that we have documented all the lesson learned and transitioned the product to the operation. Now, when this is happened one time, then it is called single phase project. So you start, you initiate a project, you plan the project, you execute it. It is only there is only one phase. There is no other. But most of the projects are not like that. Most of the projects have couple of phases like this. Any projects normally have requirement, design, construction, verification, deployment or handover. Many phases are there. And what we are trying to say is these processes are required in each phase. These processes are required in each phase. So requirement has an initiating process. You need to plan requirements, you need to execute those plan, see that if we are doing as per the planning, and if we are not doing, then take corrective measures, which is called controlling, and then identifying that an exit criteria for this phase is being met. Okay. So when we are talking about here, the closing process is to ensure that exit criteria of this phase is met, while initiating process ensures that entry criteria is met. So here, when you see that when we move from one phase to another phase, like from requirement to design phase, there are something get transferred from requirement to design phase. Normally in this case is a requirement document. Now when the requirement document, we should, in the closing phase, we should ensure that the requirement document is ready and it will facilitate the design. And initiating process in the design phase ensures that requirements are sufficient enough and matured enough to put up a design. And such kind of checking we do in every phase, and this kind of checking is called phase exit, kill points, decision gates, stage gates, and so on. Now this you see kind of discrete, but that is not how normally things happen. Normally things happen this way. There are overlapping phases. Means before the requirement get closed completely, your design phase has already started. This is normally what we, how we execute projects, right? So what do we do normally? Our requirements before get totally closed, we design, once the requirements are matured and we have a mature requirement, though it's not all the requirements have been collected, but because the initiating process here says that we, that entry criteria is met, we can start the phase. And similarly here, and similarly. So we normally have some kind of overlapping in general. Now before we finish the design phase, some kind of construction is already started. It all depends upon what is the dependency here. If there is a dependency in between, then there is a possibility that there will be a time delay. But normally, as I said, this is not a such a practical scenario. The more practical scenario is this. This is what, how we normally execute our projects. So I don't see there is any delay. Moreover, we start even before the fees get closed. Overlapping of the phase is required for clear understanding. Probably because there is one, there are a couple of things actually. One is fast tracking the project. They, by overlapping these phases, we save time. So to start the design, you don't need 100% requirement. Even 50, 60, 70% requirements are good enough for you to start the design. So it saves time. Second thing, because the requirements and designs are all both happening, as you have said, that it provides a better understanding. It provides a better understanding. Right? So design is happening. Requirements are also happening. If there is some lacuna, there are some issues which you find in design, there is a fair possibility that you go back into the requirement and fix it. Otherwise, it may be a kind of rework. Even today, it is rework, but it is much better. So this kind of handshaking also, like, it facilitates. So let's come to the project management processes. And these project management processes have been divided into process groups and knowledge areas. So you see process groups, as I explained, we have initiating processes, we have planning processes, execution processes, and closing processes, monitoring and controlling processes. So complete all the processes in, there are 47 processes which are divided into these parts. Okay, on the other side, and these processes interact in this manner. So first project start with initiating process. As soon as the initiation process starts, the planning process also start after some time. And immediately the monitoring and control process starts. The monitoring and control is from end to end. Now after some time, when the planning process start, execution also start, because you have to prepare the plan for initial phase. Like say you have prepared the plan for requirement phase, you need not to have the complete plan, right? But you can always, once the requirement phase planning is done, you can start executing it. So once the requirement phase planning is done, your execution is start, and planning and execution go into parallel. In fact, if you see from here to here, planning, execution and monitoring and control processes go hand in hand. Means plan, execute, check if we are going as per the plan. If we are not, either the course need to be corrected or the plan need to be corrected. So correct the plan, again execute, again monitor. And therefore you see this kind, this is this circuit. This happens from as the planning starts and till the time we complete all the deliverables to move into closure. Now, one is horizontal, like the matrix. This is also a matrix kind of framework. One is horizontal from planning to closure. But when we move from initiation to closure, we need to take care of all these aspects of the project management, which are called, which are termed as knowledge areas in PMBOK. So from initiation to closure, you need to take care of the scope management. What is scope? What need to be done? When need to be done? Time management. And how much we need to do? Cost management. Who will do? Resource management. People should know about it, or the stakeholders should, they are interested, they want to know about it. So we need to communicate. Okay, so communication management. We have to maintain the quality of the project and product both. So manage the quality. There is a possibility in the project that you need to procure several things, maybe raw material or any other product which is part of your final product need to be procured from outside. In that case, you need to manage the procurement. Definitely there are uncertainty attached to the projects. We should identify as many uncertainty as possible which can impact the project's outcome and document them and call risk management. And the most important part, as I said, which make and break the projects is the stakeholder management, looking at the needs, requirements, power, influence and dealing with them in that manner is called stakeholder management. And this all has to happen in an integrated manner. And because of this, project management becomes little challenging, difficult. So many things need to be taken care of all the time. And that too in an integrated manner means all are going synchronously. What need to be done, when to be done, and how much we need to do, who will do, let people know about it, manage the quality, manage the vendor, identify uncertainties, and manage all the people in and out of the project who are any way related to the project, and meeting their requirement is what project management is all. And with this horizontal and vertical, we put all the processes like that. There are total 47 processes. So horizontally it goes like initiation, planning, execution, monitoring and control, and project integration management has 5 processes. The first will fall into initiation, second falls into planning, third falls into execution, fourth and fifth falls into monitoring and control, and the sixth falls in closing process. Similarly, scope management have 6 processes, 4 are part of the planning and 2 are part of the monitoring. Similarly, time management, cost management, you will see there are a lot of processes in planning. In fact, the planning is the most important part of the project, and therefore most of the processes you will find that they are in planning. Execution has, or monitoring and control is next less, and execution has next less, and then initiation and closing. You will see in the execution, whatever you see, there are 2-3 things which we normally do in execution. You will see that 3 processes of human resource are in execution. 1 process of ensuring the quality and communicating with the people. managing stakeholders are part of execution. While other sectors, you will find the execution process is empty. That shows that planning is most important. During execution, it is the focus should be on managing the team, helping team, developing the team, removing the roadblocks from the team, what team is doing, so that they can perform. Keep all the people around communicated. Talk with the vendor, talk with all the people in the group. So if you see 70-80% in the execution is people, people and people. And if you do that during execution, if you have put a good plan in place, you will be able to do this in execution because people know what need to be done. You need to only help them out removing roadblocks. And then monitoring and control is something which is important to understand that execution is happening as per plan or not, and then making corrective measures. And then the close-up. So when the project starts, we normally do two things. That is, we prepare a project charter and identify all the stakeholders. When we move into planning process, you will see the most crowded area. We need to plan each and every aspect of the project before we start executing it. We can do it slowly. Means we plan it out in the first phase, let's say requirement. When the requirements are happening, we can plan it out for design and maybe some part of construction. When design is happening, we can plan it out the complete construction, which is the largest portion during of execution and closer. So we can do progressive planning, but we need to put the planning of all the aspects of the project. And a plan which is comprising of all the aspects of the plan is called project management plan. Then the execution, where you will see that most of the stuff is about people and managing people, stakeholders, managing team, motivating them, getting the job done from them, taking their contribution, keeping them satisfied is what the job is. Monitoring control normally looks for measuring the variance between the execution and plan, the plan versus actual, and if there is a variance, taking an approach, taking an efforts, taking measures to reduce variance or eliminate it. At the time of closing, it is mainly first close the procurement and then close the project, because before you close the project, everything need to be closed. So therefore, the procurement of this project is also be closed before you close the project. The project management framework is covered. If you have any question, you can take that question. Our complete remaining course is all about these processes which I have just explained you, which are you see in a table form, divided into like process groups and knowledge areas, and we will go one by one knowledge area and discuss about these processes. We'll start from integration. No question? Okay, would you like to take a break for 10 minutes? Okay, so it is 7:20 right now. Let's resume at 7:30. Okay. Okay. So let me take you through this EMP certification exam, the overview of it. And let's try to understand what is important there, what exactly the exam is and what is important there. I hope all are back. Anybody who is not back can write here. Okay, so whomsoever is not writing, I believe he's there back. Okay. So there are four things which we will discuss here. We'll take an overview. We'll talk about tips to pass the PMP exam. We also talk about some PMIism, that is what PMI think, and once you become PMP, how to sustain your PMP certification, that is how to earn PDUs. The eligibility criteria is very simple. I believe most of the people are here at bachelor's degree, so only the first one applies. You should have minimum 4,500 hours of project management experience, that is more or less 3 years. You have spent time in working on project management related activities, not necessarily be a project manager, but project management related activities. And you should have 35 hours of formal project management training. So this you need, I think most of you already have it. This criteria will be fulfilled by this training. So you will get a certificate after this training and you are fully eligible to apply for the PMP exam. Okay, the experience should be required in all five process groups. Initiation, planning, execution, monitoring, control and closure. However, no minimum is defined anywhere, so even 1 hour will work. So in some project you might have worked on initiations, in some project you might have worked in initiation and planning, in some of the project you must have worked in execution and closing, in some project in planning, execution, monitoring, in some only your monitoring. All projects put together, you should have experience in all the process areas, process groups, and it should exceed 4,500 of hours. Only last 8 years are normally considered. Not normally, they are only last 8 years are considered. A PMP exam is of 4 hours. You will get 200 multiple choice questions, one will be right. You have to score 61% to pass. Now, there's this uniqueness in the PMP exam, which I haven't seen anywhere else, that out of 200 questions, there are 25 questions are on test. So, you will take them right or wrong, it does not matter. They're not going to be counted. But you don't know them. So you don't know which 25 questions are pre-release means on the test, on which your response will not be counted. So you consider that you have to you have 200 multiple choice questions and you need to secure 61% marks. To cover up this 25%, consider that you need to get 65% marks. It's better. So it will be safe. Okay, so out of 175 questions, 106 questions are to be right. The point here is that you have 69 questions to mark them incorrectly. Even then you will pass, which is a good number in my opinion. 69, almost 70 questions which you can mark incorrectly, even then you will pass. I think it's a fair possibility that you will pass. Most of the people complete the exam well before time. So it is 4 hours, but normally people complete this in 3.5 hours. And rest of the time they normally use it to review their answers. Initiation have 13% contribution, planning 24%, execution 30%. Monitoring and control 25% and 8% closer in the question number of questions which you are seeing, they will come like this. So 30% question will be from initiation, 8% questions will be from closing. It was specifically mentioned earlier couple of years ago that professional and social responsibility also have a share. Now it is still have a share, but there is no percentage allocated to it. So still there will be questions which may not only be checking that your answer is right, but it should be ethically right as well, meeting to the project, to the PMI's code of conduct. There is no negative marking, so you should answer all the questions. It will be a pen and paper exam or online exam. It is an online exam, but online is not like you can do it from home. I explain you in coming slides. The exam fee is $555. If you become member, the exam fee reduced to $405. But you have to pay a membership fee of $148, which is the total of 405 and 148 come out to be 553. That is more or less same. So you going to spend $555, either you become member or not. Becoming member and then applying is beneficial because you get 1 year membership free. Now, how are we going to meet the training requirement? Who can meet the training requirement? There are six criteria which are given for selecting the training company or the person who can give you training. One is PMI component, maybe the PMI chapters or SIG, specific interest group. They can conduct program. There are registered education provider, the people like me if or any other who is providing the education or who is conducting such courses can approach PMI and can register themselves. Employer can conduct your company or employer can conduct the program and give you a certificate that you have undergone through this program. Training companies or consultants like us. Training companies or consultants like the people who are not registered with PMI. So registration with a PMI is not a must here. So training companies or consultants like us who can conduct the training and give you a certificate of training. Distance learning companies including end of course assessment. So if you are participating in any distance learning course and project management is one of the subject there, then that time which you are spending on project management can be treated against the training, but end of course assessment is required. University, college, academic and continuing education program can be also be part of it. So suppose you are doing an MBA and there is a subject for project management there, then the time you spend or the training you get on project management, only on project management, not other section of MBA or the subject of MBA, only project management, that can be counted towards 35 hours. Now, there are a lot of confusion around it, so let me clarify that first of all, because the contents are not recommended by PMI, you can take any project management training of any duration, not necessarily 35 hours. But all the trainings together should become more than 35 hours or more. So if you have taken 8 hours, 5 training in project management, knowledge areas on the different subject in project management, then you can combine together and say, okay, I have taken these 5 trainings, I have total more than 35 hours of training with me. One day normally considered as 9-7 days, normal, not this way, but we are doing. Okay, so there are a lot of confusion around it, which I want to clarify that first of all, REPs are not must. There are many other ways to get the REPs, one out of 6. There are many other ways to get your training and get your certificate, and not necessarily that you have to have training on PMBOK only, and you have to take the training in 35 training only of 35 hours. You can have any number of trainings in project management altogether become more than 35 hours, and they should be a project management subject, not anything else. However, not necessarily be on PMBOK. Then how this kind of training which we are doing right now will help, or is it required? It is not necessary as such kind of training, but it will help you to prepare for the exam, which other training may not do. It will give you a kind of jump start in your preparation. It will give you guidance on how to prepare and then apply. This is what the advantage of. When you calculate your experience, it can be calculated like that. You have to report your every project where you have experience, project-wise experience, you have to provide to the PMI when you apply online. The only thing which need to be taken care of here is that if you are working on 2 projects in parallel, the time is still single. You cannot count it 2 times because you are working on 2 projects. It is a linear time which is being considered. If you are working on 3 projects during 1 month, it is not 3 months, it is only 1 month. Now this is one of the sample that how you need to report your experience. So for every project, this is what you need to fill up. I have this Excel separately. I can give you that Excel. What you can do, because this is the most time consuming place where when you're applying online. So you can document your experience in the Excel for each project, and then when you apply online, you can copy paste from this Excel. This is a simple process of certification process. You apply, you start filling up your form. You have 90 days to complete the form, so you can save it temporarily also. Draft, save as draft. Once you complete and submit your project, your application, your application will be reviewed and approved, and it will normally take 5 months, maximum 5 days. You make the payment, and if your application is not approved, it may go through an audit process. Normally 10% of the applications are selected for auditing. So your and there is no specific criteria, randomly they are picked up, so your application can also fall into audit process, and if so happens, they will send you several forms to fill up and you can respond on that by giving the proofs of your experience, of your education, of your basically educational experience and your qualification. And once you submit all this proof, they will review it and approve it. Then you have, once it is approved, you have 1 year from that date to take the exam. Within that 1 year, you need to take the exam. You can take up to 3 times in 1 year. And my understanding that you don't need to think about how many times, because you should pass in the first try. And I don't think there is anything which is afford any next. The second attempt even is affordable from the mental point of view and the financial point. As soon as you give the exam, you submit the exam, you will be flashed with the answer, with the result, pass or fail, that's all, nothing else. Okay, you will get a report which will tell you in which area you are perform how much, but no marks. How much you have secured, nobody knows. You will pass or fail. Okay, once you pass, you become PMP. And then there is a 3 years recertification cycle. In this 3 year, you need to earn 60 PDUs. 60 PDUs called PDU called professional development units. And these units you need to earn by doing some project management related activities, by education, by taking some education, by imparting some education, by doing some active volunteer activities, by doing some self study. There are methods which I tell you later. As soon as you get 60 PDUs, you will be given, you will get a notice to renew your certification. Okay. Now your certification will be, whenever you renew your certification, it will be renewed from 3 years from the date you pass the PMP exam. So it is 3 years. So next you become 6 years. If you fail to get 60 PDUs, your after 3 years, your certification will be suspended for 1 year, giving you opportunity to earn 60 PDUs and reinstate your certification. If you get all 60 PDUs, your certification will be, and you apply for recertification, your certification get renewed. Otherwise, it will expire. If your application get selected for audit, you have to provide, you have to give your proof of your PhD degree, experience, proof of the experience which you have given all the projects which you have submitted, and 35 hours training program certification. Whatever certificate you will, like in this case, we will provide a certificate, the certificate you need to submit. They will give you kind of all this information, how to submit the application. Normally it is not so difficult, and PMI I have seen is pretty lenient in getting the in reviewing the certification. If you are genuinely proved that you have done this, then normally it is acceptable. Now take care of some tips to prepare for the exam. Remember that exam is based on PMBOK. That is, what is mentioned and referenced in PMBOK is the basis of exam. The exam is a test of PMI methodology. PMI, I say philosophy and methodology. So PMI philosophy and methodology may not match with your experience. In that case, you please give priority to PMI methodology and philosophy, not yours or not your experience. Read PMBOK 5th edition. Understand all the chapters, all the processes, all the things, tools and techniques which are mentioned in PM Bob, and also which are referenced but not fully explained in PM Bob. We cover all those things in our training program. As I said, only real life experience is not sufficient, but it is very important to understand concepts in PM Bob. Real life experience is very important, but it is not sufficient because you need to think from the PMI perspective, not your perspective when you're giving the exam. Most of the questions are situational means providing a situational and situation and are asking you that what is the first thing you will do in this, what is the best thing to do. So there will be four options, and most of the people say that they find two or three options very close to each other and they find it difficult to decide. And that's the challenge in PMP exam. Most of the questions are suggested. Therefore, the mix your experience as well as the study of PM Bob is important. So you need to do some sample questions. We will help you out that with our virtual learning center that so that you know that what kind of questions appear there. Something in the book or comes in the exam which is sometimes do not fit very logical. Sometimes like input, output, tools and techniques which are defined for each process. We may need to memorize them. But if you have studied thoroughly, if you have taken a good number of questions, I think most of the stuff you will memorize, remember. There is no negative marking, so please answer all the questions. It is not necessary to use all the information in the question because question could be very wordy. There could be a lot of information while not all the information may be required to answer the questions. Now, beware that in the options, many options will be universally right. They are always right, like sun rises from the east. But those things probably will not be right because the questions are normally specific and generic things are not the answer of those questions because the question is specific. As I said, answer the question from the PMI perspective. Now, if you are not very sure about the question, then to get a good guess of the right answer, you can use such kind of things that normally generic statements or generally true statements are not the answers. Global words are often incorrect, like always, never, because situations are specific and never, always are normally not specific. They are generalized. What is critical to respond to the question is most, best, like what you do first. What is the best action in this case? Such thing will appear in the last sentence of the question, and this could be critical in answering that question or selecting the option. Now we keep telling that whatever your experience is, you think from the PMI perspective. What is that PMI perspective? We have termed it as PMIism. So PMIism is a PMI philosophy. Whatever your experience is, please answer from the PMI's perspective. What is this perspective? There's project charter is a must to start a project. I have seen very few projects have it. But please consider project charter is a must. Project manager have all kind of soft and hard skills. In practice, it may not be, but it is what is required here. Project manager is authorized by charter and has authority to take any action. So his authority may be limited, but PMI's questions understand that your project manager is authorized to take any action in the interest of project. Project manager take an active approach. This is project manager is proactive. So in the option, if you see there are two options which are very near to each other, and one is passive and one is proactive, select the proactive. Normally, in your database, lesson learns are available from all previous projects in your historical database. No, whatever there in the scope, only that much is to be delivered, and full scope need to be delivered, and only the scope is delivered. Any extra feature is not permitted or is not approved. It is called as code plating. So do not provide any extra feature to the client, but whatever you provide, provide in a much better shape and much better quality. Work breakdown structure, it is the like breaking the total work into in hierarchical structure. Is work breakdown structure is a wonderful tool. It is really. Roles and responsibility matrix are defined in all the projects. That is RACI matrix, which I we talked about some time back. Somebody mentioned about it. Now, it is something different than generally thought of. Working overtime is the last resort. All other options must be tried out. In the practice, this could be the first option. But from the PMI perspective, it is the last option. A performance criteria in terms of earned value management is deployed, and it is used to measure the performance. All changes must go through change management process. Project manager go and take the acceptance from the customer for all the deliverables. All stakeholders need to be identified as early as possible. Lesson learns are documented or consolidated during the closure, and whatever the measures you do, project managers or you should continuously evaluate the effectiveness of those measures. Now, once you become PMP, you need to earn PDUs. How you can earn PDUs? This is what it is. This is post PMP. 60 PDUs in 3 years. If you are employed and do project management work, you get 5 PDUs per year. There are 6 categories: A, B, C, D, E, F. So in category F is, if you are employed somewhere and do project management work, you get 5 PDUs per year by doing your work. So you need not to do anything special. For 15 PDUs, you get in 3 years. So you need to work only for 45 PDUs. You can attend some educational program in project management, category A and B. Category A is meant for PMI chapters and registered education provider, and if you are attending some project management training in your organization, in any other places, in your college, by attending some webinars, some seminars by which are not PMI chapters or not REPs, like you attend a human resource seminar. They may not be REP nor the PMI, but because it's a human resource related, and human resource is one of the important part of project management, you can claim PDUs for that. Okay, and then it will be category B. So if you are PMP and attend our training programs, they will fall into category B. If you attend, we do free webinars many times. I think for sometimes we are on hold for this, but we will soon restart it, and if you it is normally we do a 1.5 hour webinar, and if you attend it, you get 1.5 PDs. We're going to restart again. Right now it is on hold. If you don't find any other area, you can take up a project management book. You can read some journals of project management. You can gain some knowledge. You can watch some recorded stuff, and document this, what you have learned from where. So you can earn up to 30 PDUs under this category without any kind of support from anyone. Just need to spend some time to gain some knowledge in project management. You can also offer volunteer services to PMI, which is, I am one of the very active volunteer of the PMI, and my recent work was that I led efforts to translate PMBOK from English to Hindi. So if you want some Hindi PMBOK, it is also available. Maybe I will suggest it to Prasad. We'll be looking for something, maybe he will find it useful. So I keep doing some volunteer activities. I'm also a blogger, so I keep writing blogs for PMI, and you can find this on blog.pmi.org. This call it Voice of Project Management. So if you give some volunteer services to PMI or PMI chapters, you can earn some PDUs, which are sometimes it is time based, sometimes it is defined by the PMI that there is so many PDUs for this activity. If you are a speaker, if you conduct some webinar, if you write some blog, if you write some article in some magazine, you will get PDUs under category D. So if you see any kind of activities you are doing in project management, there is an opportunity to earn PDUs. This is all about PMP exam. So whatever I have covered is not answered any of your question. So the exam is something like that. Exam is online. So once your application is approved, they will send you a list of prometic centers. And these prometic centers, you have to go to the prometic center site and schedule your exam. At the scheduled time, you go to the prometic center, give the exam, which is an online, but it isn't in the controlled environment. Once you submit your exam, you will get the result immediately. For all the people in this virtual room, the Prometic Center is there in near Sakinaga in Marwa House. Either you are in Mumbai or in Pune. All around, all the year, you have to schedule your exam. They will send you a list of prometic center for Pune and Mumbai. There is a center in Marwa House near Sakinaka. Yeah, correct. That's the place only. You have to go see that vacant slot and book yourself.
Yes, I think after 3 years we have to reappear for the exam, right?
No, you need not to reappear. If you have 60 PDUs, you just need to apply for renew your certification.
So without reappearing the exam, just we have to submit the PDUs and okay. I mean after completion of 3 years also, right?
Right. This 60 PDUs requirement is for renewal only. So after become PMP, in next 3 years, you need to, your certification is valid for 3 years. Within that 3 years, you need to accumulate, earn these 60 PDUs. As soon as you earn 60 PDUs, they will send you a notice to renewal.
Okay, renewal for another 3 years, right?
For another 3 years, right.
Okay.
And then you again earn 60 PDUs, and then they will again renew you for 3 years.
Okay, got it.
You have to reappear exam only once your certification expires.
Okay.
Who authorizes whether I have earned a PDUs? No, like suppose you have attended a webinar for 2 hours anywhere. Suppose the PMV has organized this, you attended it. So we will normally send you an email that which is confirms your attendance for that much hours in the webinar. Using that, keep this email as safe, and some kind of proof should be there to prove that you attended or you have invested so much time in learning PM, project management. Then you go to the PMI site, there is a continuing certification portion is there, where there is a facility to claim PDUs. So there is a form, you go there, fill up the form and submit it. And PMI will review it and approve your PDUs. Once your approved PDUs are approved, they will appear in your credit. Okay. No further question, right? If there are no further questions, we will move to integration management. What is an integration management? It's basically starting a project. It's basically a central stage, you can say, starting a project, then preparing a plan which comprises of plan for all the knowledge areas, scope, time, cost, communication, risk, procurement, resource, cost, etc. Preparing a plan, consolidated plan, that is what integration is all about. So you, in the individual areas, you prepare individual plan, but the integration plan, you, integration management, you consolidate them, unify them. Okay, then executing the project. So taking care of monitoring the execution part of the project, though we will discuss about specific execution things which are in human resource, quality, stakeholders, but there is a global approach to the execution, overall guidance of the execution, which actually integration provides. We normally say that project management managers actually sit into integration. whomsoever doing integration, who is whomsoever is giving overall guidance, whomsoever is taking guiding the complete project and taking the complete project, that person is actually project manager. Designation doesn't matter. And then overall assessing the performance of the project and taking corrective measures. And at the end of the, once all is done, then ensuring that lesson learns are consolidated, documented, and the outcome of the project is transferred to the operations. So when you initiate a project or when you plan the project, what you need to do, you trade off in the objectives, alternatives, you prepare a project charter, you tailor the processes, what processes are required for this project or what are not. You see that what are the interdependency among the various knowledge area and various aspects of the projects. You ensure that complete project is going or working as one piece. Right? And right deliverables are coming at the right time. Dependencies are being met at the right time. People are not, such a situation should not arise that people have completed the things and waiting for something to happen. So if that wait is there, then it is going to kill your project. So that is what the project manager has to ensure, that such a waiting time shouldn't happen in the project. The deliverables should be properly defined, dependencies are properly defined, and they have been taken care of so that the project will flow in rhythm. So that giving that rhythm to the project is the project manager's primary goal. So there are six processes. So we'll see that what is the project charter, preparing a plan, how directing and managing the project execution, monitoring and controlling, and also ensuring the change control process, and then closing the project. So what a project charter is and why we need a project charter. Why do you think any organization take a project? Why an organization go ahead and take a project for execution? What is the primary purpose? To get revenue, right? Any other? Get experience in project execution. Okay. Let me ask you one question. Will your organization to generate revenue will go in the market and pick up any project from which the revenue can be earned? Or organizations are selective in taking the project? Selectively, always, yes. So organization do not go in the market and take up any project, whatever. So what decide which project to take up?
I think knowledge.
Knowledge. But what will decide which project not to take and which project to take?
Think knowledge and strengths of our area. where we have strong enough.
Where we have strength, we have
Right.
capabilities and interest, right? Profit or more. So any company based on its capabilities, on interest, strength, weaknesses, looking at this, form a strategy, right? Looking at the risky areas, they form a strategy, and that strategy actually play a role in selecting the project. Now, when you have taken the project, because there is a strategy behind picking up the project, we should always see that our project execution should match with that strategy. When project is under execution, we hardly look at the what was the strategy to pick up this project. How many times during execution do you think about what was the strategy of the organization to pick up this project? And are we adhering to that project, that strategy or not? How many times we ponder on this question? What was the strategy, and are we meeting that, or are we as per the strategy going on as per the strategy? Many times. And what is how we connect this? Is there any document you have which connect this? You will not
I think there should be a feasibility study.
A feasibility study is for risky, to find the risk.
I mean, before going to start up the project, we have to analyze it, what triggers two things.
I agree with
and
you.
And the cost benefit analysis and market and
yes. See, normally feasibility study is done to see that how much risk is there in the project. If something new is coming up or something which is not very sure, it's a kind of risk mitigation kind of effort. But if you see, we do check that is this project aligned with our strategy. If we have taken up, it is somehow aligned, but we have to continuously check, are we not deviating from our main strategy? Many times we do. Yeah, so, no, RFP and RFI are actually issued by the customer. It's nothing to do with our organization, RFP, RFI. RFP, RFI means we are aligned with the customer, not organization. Because RFP, RFI is given by customer, not issued by our organization. We define using them, but what is that document? Actually, that is a project charter, but we normally do not have project charter in the project. But this statement is not fully true, that we do not have project charter in the project. If I say we do not have project charter document in the project, then it will be right. Because there is no project without a charter. There is always a charter. The only thing is that, have we documented it or not? So most of the time we do not document it. What is IPD? It didn't get what is IPD. when we initiate policy, we document it. Okay. Any project. Okay. So we need to document some kind of, see, because we have a charter, and charter is decided by the strategy of the organization and requirement of the customer. So we have two objectives. One is organization objective, one is client's objective. In fact, we have multiple objectives. I'm talking about goal, multiple objectives. Some objectives, so if we have defining objectives of the project, they are drawn from customer's objective and organization objective. If we are meeting customer objective, defeating the organization, organization will find it useless for itself, because it is not purpose, it is not solving the purpose for which the project was taken. That is not meeting the organization strategy, and that fails the project from the organization point of view. But if we meet the organization objective but fail to deliver the project with on their objectives, the customer find it meaningless, because maybe we are successful within the organization, but customer will not be happy because his objectives are not met. And that's what the charter does. The charter actually will define objectives from the organization point of view and customer point of view, and that therefore we say charter connect the project to the organization strategy. Charter is something which is prepared by a senior person and given it to the project manager. Basically, giving a charter to a project manager is something like that, telling the project, identifying a project manager and telling him that this is a project which this organization has taken up. You lead this project and apply, and you are authorized to apply organizational resources on this project. This is what project charter is. So project, through project charter, project manager is authorized, is identified and authorized. There are some, it has objectives, it has connected the organization and customer's strategy to the project. It also collect very high level requirements, so it has to give guidance, right? So it has a very high level requirements. It has a milestone plan. It has a budget which is allocated to this project. It has maybe high level risk which may hit the project, and something which is important and required for guiding the project. That is what project charter is. Every project has a charter, but most of the project do not document it. And when you do not document anything, there is a risk of this getting changed over time. Your objective should not change over time. You stay with the strategy, you stay with the objective of the project. It is important that you should document it and prepare a project charter and continue looking at it. Otherwise, deviation, if you close your eyes from that, deviation is very easy. To do this, you need to have a project statement of work, that is, which is given by the project, by the client, a statement of work. Business case, what is a business case? The project charter also has a business case. A business case is a justification for the investment. Why we are taking up the project? What is the purpose we are trying to solve? What is the question we are going to answer? That is what the business case. The real reason behind the project. All the objectives are met, business case is not met, your project is failed. The agreement between the vendor and the customers. Some enterprise EEE and OPA, which I just specified what they are, so they may change time to time, but they will be in most of the processes. What you need is some kind of facilitate, kind of meeting techniques to facilitate a kind of meeting and understanding of the objectives and various artifacts of the project. And you need an experienced person, which is called expert judgment. What is expert judgment? Expert judgment is an expert, judgment of an expert. So basically, we are talking about expert who has a knowledge and experience and skills to do so. In this case, it's a project charter. So that is business case. Business case is a business need for the project. Why this project be? It could be market demand. It could be technological advancement. Market pressure. Technology is advanced. We are working with the previous technology. We are not able to cater to the customer requirements. Migrate to the new technology. The law has changed. So comply with the law. So you do whatever do in the project, but if you fail to comply the law, the project will fail. So what is the juxtaposition advertisement? We talk about any person who has experience, knowledge and understanding of doing that work. In this case, project charter. Consultant, external, could be external, internal, could be a team member, could be an external team member, could be part of the organization but not a team member, any other stakeholder, it could be a customer also, it could be a subject matter expert, it could be a person from the PMO. So what is, when the charter comes out, how it looks like? It provides a purpose, objectives and justification, business case, project objective and success criteria, and why, when it will be called success, high level requirements, project description, high level risk, milestone schedule, budget, any approval requirements, how many more. Actually it's not limited to this, but you need to define in your organization separately. Show you a sample. How it looks like. It has an objective, description of the project manager, business case, why this project is being taken up, what is the scope of the project, what are the high level deliverables, you define the scope of the project. Milestone schedule, stakeholders which are important for this project, high level risk, and other details as when required. But normally it should be one page or maximum two page. We should summarize all the, because it's a giving guidance, it is not providing all the details. It should be one or two page, and some senior person has to write. Alternatively, project manager can write but get the sign from the senior person. Now once you have the project management, project charter, the next step is to start preparing the project plan. And what is a project management plan? It is comprising of all the subsidiary plan, that is scope management plan, time management plan, communication plan, human resource management plan, risk management plan. All the plans consolidated in one area is called project management plan. One document containing management plan for each knowledge area. How the project will be executed, what is the methodology we are going to use, what are the tools and techniques we are going to use. It could be progressively elaborated, as I said, because initially it is difficult to plan the complete project, you plan only for requirements. When the requirements are happening, you plan for design and some kind of instruction. When design is happening, you plan for construction. When construction is happening, you plan for verification and for delivery. That is called progressive elaboration. As you move into the project, you come to know more and more about it. All projects are progressively elaborated. Project charter is one of the input. Output of the planning process means output of the scope management plan, plan scope management, output of the plan time management, output of the plan cost management like that. So that you can consolidate and prepare one project management plan. Again, you need the purpose to facilitate meeting discussion points. Facilitation techniques are like discussing with the team members and other stakeholders. An expert means an experienced project manager. Like brainstorming, conflict resolution, problem solving. So what a project management plan normally contains? Integrate and consolidate all the subsidiary plan and baselines. And baseline the project. So once you execute, you should baseline the project. Life cycle for the project and selected processes. You must identify what kind of life cycle of this project. Tailor the processes. Level of implementation of selected process. Select the process and also decide the level of implementation. How deep we will go in these processes. So it is tailoring the process. This is one of the very, very important part. And most of the people who says that quality department of PMO is talking about or become too much bureaucratic. Actually, quality department of PMO is not bureaucratic, but we have adopted some processes from the global processes which are not applicable to our projects, which we would have avoided. But we didn't do a tailoring, and therefore this becomes a problem. Do benchmark, be consider facilitating techniques. Benchmarking is not facilitating. Facilitating technique is something which you can come along with other people and discuss about something. That is what they have termed as facilitating techniques. See, these terms are defined in PMI and only meaning here. Outside, they may mean differently. Okay, so that we need to understand. That not globally facilitation technique means this only. Involvement of the people on project capability and discussing about this matter, any matter. We should also describe any tools and techniques which we are going to use. We should also list down the methodology the project is going to be executed, how the change management plan will be, configuration management plan should be part of it. We should also define the baseline and the base and the basis on which this will be measured. So it is a overall project management plan which contains the plan for everything. Maybe I will show you some sample plan or sample or kind of sample which will give an idea what kind of things should be there. See, this is one of the plan. This is just one plan. It is not the only plan. So this is just a sample which will give an idea that what kind of plan we should have. So you have project overview, organization responsibilities, how the phases are, baseline the planning, what are the resource requirements, defining deliverables, risk management plan, all the standard and conventional equity used in the project, quality management plan, or quality equipment plan, all things, reputation management plan, how we're going to configure the all the items which are identified on the project. So all the assumptions are the assumption and dependencies are documented. So it's very important that we should document all the assumptions, because every assumption is subject to become risk. Look at this. All the deliverables are defined phase wise, that in which phase what will be delivered, and who is, what kind of skills are required, and who is responsible. All the type of resources, resource management, human resource management. From which date to that date. Phase wise. What kind of infrastructure we need. These are also resources. What kind of hardware, software, or any kind of raw material in case of other manufacturing, or in case of say construction. All this need to be mentioned. Then you also talk about how to baseline a project, where the schedule of the complete schedule is mentioned. So it is separate, so it is referenced here. Communication management plan is also separate, so it is also mentioned here. When monitoring and control, how does this will happen? All the deliverables. Risk management plan is mentioned, that how the risk will be taken care of, how risk will be identified, how we will measure the risk impact, and how we take the actions. Standard and conventions, it is even shown that how the release will be named. Testing, the approach for testing is there. Quality control is mentioned. Quality plan is mentioned. Metrics is defined, what we need going to measure. How the verification and validation will happen. What kind of tools and techniques will be used during the project. What is our defect prevention plan? How are we going to prevent the defects on the project? Acceptance criteria. Configuration management plan, how items on the project will be identified and configured. In a construction project, you say where is the inventory, what is lying where in how much quantity. The same is here on the software part, the documentation part. When you have documents, you should have a proper structure where the documents will be like stored. So nowadays everything is going softer, so we should have a configuration management, like where what documents will be stored in the directory structure. So that is what it is. Naming conventions are defined. All the guidelines, all the things need to be executed are mentioned in this. Change control process is defined. How change will be incorporated in the project. Otherwise, a lot of scope creep will happen. Make sense? So the third is managing, direct and managing the project execution. So here is mainly guiding the execution of the project. When the team is creating deliverables, the project managers need to look after the, you know, the people who are producing deliverables and see that what is stopping them to do their work. Take steps to improve their capabilities. Take steps to bring resources to them all time. Collect the data. During execution, one of the most important things is that the data gets generated. And if you don't collect the data, you will never come to know how you are performing. So collection of that data actually tells us how we are performing. The reality, it will tell us. And then we need to know what, measure it with or compare it with our plan and then see what actions are required. So actions are driven by the data collected. If data is not collected, the action will not be appropriate. Establishing and managing the communication. The communication is one of the very important things because the project manager more than 90% of the time actually communicate. In fact, most of the time he is communicating. Looking at the risk, identifying if any risk is getting materialized. So, for directing and managing the project, you need a project management plan. And more, the changes which are approved by the change control board, which become part of the project. You need an experienced project manager, the project management information system, that is something like an enterprise project management system. PMI also think that meeting is a tool. I don't know how they consider it as a tool, but this is how it is defined. You may or may not consider, but for exam purpose, please do consider. What is the main output is the deliverable. One is deliverable. And the collection of actual data, how we have performed. Every execution and monitoring and control process has a change request. Means when you are executing the project, when you are preparing deliverables, when you are constructing the things, at that time you may come to know some lacunas or some gaps for which you can raise a change request to fill this gap. So most of the execution and monitoring and control process have change requests as one of the output. So what is a PMIS? Project Management Information System is a scheduling tool like Microsoft Project, Primavera, etc. A tool which will help you to in configuration. A tool which will help you in managing the or in assessing the performance, and a tool which can help you in data analysis, and a tool which can help you in reporting the project, any tool which can help you in collecting the information. Normally enterprise project management and project management EPM, normally we say enterprise project management tool is ideally fit here. So as an output, because your team is working now, which is like we saw that kind of this graph, you remember? It goes like this. So this was initiation, then this was planning phase, this was execution, and this was closure. So you see, this is where we are talking about. You have most of the people working on it and producing deliverables. This is also important portion where you need to collect the data so that you can check against the plan and do monitoring and control process properly, that is checking with the plan and then taking corrective measures. If collected data is not right, is not accurate, is not good, then our actions will not be good. A change request is either called corrective action, preventive action, or defective action. Now, in general, in projects, you will find change request is something which is changing the scope of the project. But in PMI terminology, please understand that change request is something which is bringing change to the plan. So we have plan, we have baseline that plan. If we want to change that plan, we need to issue a change request. This could be a corrective action. This could be a preventive action, which is like we learn something today by doing something. Our project should, like this is normally the, so our project is supposed to go like this, but it is going like this. So it is underperforming. Okay, so we find it out, there's some reason X, because of that it is happening. So we take the corrective measures, corrective action. We also take preventive action so that X should not reoccur. Or if we find a defect in our testing or in our quality control, then repairing it, because repairing it required a change in the plan. So PMI definition of change request is a little different than generally understood. So you should get actual data from the team members, discuss with them, get that what actual data is, then see that deliverables are being produced, and if there is a change request, any corrective action, preventive measure, or get repair is there, which will go through the change management process. This is the overall guidance. This is, I will say, it's an encapsulation of the overall process going to, like, over and above the stakeholder management. A stakeholder, taking care of the stakeholders, taking care of the people, taking care of the team members, taking care of the quality, taking care of the communication. This is an overall umbrella of all these actions. Now when you direct the project, there will be a fair possibility that there will be some updates to the project plan or some documents which are like project risk documents, project log, stakeholders document, quality control document, communication document. Those things may change based on our experience in so far. Okay, so we have three more processes in this: monitoring control, project plan, monitoring control, change control, and closure. And I will suggest we'll take this up tomorrow. We'll carry forward from monitoring and control. You have any question? Whatever we have covered as of now, we can discuss those questions. Any general question you have related to anything, what should be related to this training, we can discuss that. I have one question. How to get these recorded sessions? Okay, these sessions are recorded. I will upload them onto the YouTube and share the link with you. Okay, you will not find it on the YouTube channel of PMBS. Otherwise, you have to use the link which I am going to provide you. Okay, so there is always a little delay. We need to look into the recording somewhere. We need to editing may happen. We try not to do that altogether, but sometimes things are not right or something. We say there is long wait time is there in that, silence is there. So we try to understand and try to make some editing, and at least try to review it by jumping through here if we can find out, and then we'll upload it and we'll share the link with you. So please expect a 2 to 3 days of delay when we share the link with you. Can you tell us something about more about WBS? No, it's going to come. It's the next step in after integration management. It will be a scope management, and we will discuss WBS on that. Other than what are other reading materials suggested? Sample, exam papers. We will give you all these information when we come to the end of this course. So we'll give you suggested study which you can do after that. Right now I suggest you to, because we give an understanding of the subjects, we do not let you read the full slides. We give you a better understanding of the subject. What I suggest right now, once this is over, if you have time or spare some time to go through the slides, because slides have much more information than what I am talking about. I give an overall understanding and try to see that if you get the concept clear. So go through the slides. If you have more time, you look into the PMBOK, so read PMBOK of that subject. We will enable, like tomorrow, we will enable the question and answer questions for you, and then for like framework integration, and probably we will complete the scope also tomorrow. So all these three, we will enable you the questions. So during the weekdays, spare some time and attempt those questions. When you attempt those questions, you try to go through the, like, do not think that you know everything. You refer handouts, the PDF is already provided to you. You refer PMBOK and then give the exam. Then attempt the question. If in case you think that you need to refer. If you are very clear, you just attempt it. So there are 30 questions normally. And 30 questions normally should be completed in 35 minutes. But we have allocated 1 hour. And the reason is that we understand not all the questions you will be able to attempt thoroughly through absolutely like you will be knowing, because you're learning. So you will refer the book, you will refer the handouts, and will then attempt the questions. And therefore it will take about an hour to attempt this question, not even take 1 hour, but then when you submit the quiz, you will get the answers. So you will check that what are the questions which you attempt incorrectly or where you were doubtful, and then see your understanding with the explanation provided in the answer. So answer is just not ABCD, answer is having an explanation. Then see that what was your understanding and what is how it is explained, and try to get that if you get the concept clear. If you do not get the concept clear, you note it down. Okay, and then when we meet next time on next Saturday, then you can bring that up, that okay, I attempted these questions, but I am not clear on these questions. So we can go through those questions and I will explain you that what is the concept or what is the funder behind that. So that's what the approach which I would like, I would suggest you to take. And once we, when we closing this session, before that I will share with you all the suggested studies after that. And what you can learn, where you can, even we can share you with internet links, where you will get some good stuff to study and good stuff to prepare. Right, any other question? Okay, so no question, great. Go through the like these slides which we have covered today, and if you get any questions, bring it up tomorrow when we start it at 6 o'clock. Okay, and till then, good weekend to you. Enjoy the daytime and come back at home in time so that you can join this session on time. Thank you very much. Good night.